coming this early. It's early for me at least. So my name is Gerwin. I'm developer from Vienna, self-employed. I do a lot of stuff in my free time where I do stuff with Google APIs, and I actually became Google Developer Expert for Google Plus, which I'm going to talk about today. And what I want to do today, I want to give you a quick overview of all the different parts which make up the Google Plus platform. And to do this, I always like to take a sort of time travel. And we're going to start back in ancient times of 2011. So back then, the Google Plus platform had just started with a very small subset of things which were available. You had the plus one button as plugin, and you had a very limited set of HTTP API. So when you look at the plus plugins, what was important is when you wanted to have a plus one button on the page, you included a certain JavaScript, the plus one.js, and if you this script is still in existence today, but it's used for much more than just the plus one button now. So either you could include the script just directly, or you could go ahead and make it an asynchronous call to load it to improve page performance. And then you just included a simple div somewhere in the page where you wanted to have the plus one button with some parameters, and then you would get this plus one button, which doesn't look anything like it at all anymore, because now it looks like this. And so that was the only sort of plugin you could put on your website if you wanted to do anything with Google Plus back then. You also had a very limited HTTP API, which basically means you could request public data from Google Plus. You send requests to an API, you get the JSON in response. One thing you could get information about people. This is a very simple call, really. Let's just open this up. So you take the user ID and you execute, and what you would get is public information about the user. You got nickname, gender, you got URL. So basically you got the public information which you would have on the Google Plus profile. So it's not very exciting really. So what you could do with this, you could take the information on your page and, for example, render a simple batch which you want to display on your website, for example, using this information. Another thing you could do is you could request public activities. So you could say, I want to see everything this person has posted publicly on Google Plus. So that's another call here. So what I'm using here is the API Explorer, which is really useful if you want to play around with any of the Google APIs. It's just a simple way to try calls and see what the results look like. Basically, when we execute this request, we get here a list of items. Each item is a plus activity. In this case, I actually posted about the DevFest day yesterday, and you see who posted it, you see the whole contents of the post, you would see number of plus ones, and you would see attachments. In this case, it was the link that was attached. So actually get all the information that's visible in a post on Google Plus you would get through the API. And again, what you could do with this information is you could take the information and render, for example, if you want on a website, you want to have your recent activity on your website, you could use the API to get the data and put it on your website, because there is no widget for you to do that. But it's really simple to do a simple widget like this as well. Or what you could also do, you can take all your activities and run some analytics through them, because you have the date of the posting. And so, for example, here, this is my recent behavior on what weekdays I post the most often and at what hours. So you see I usually sleep somewhere between 4 and 9. So, and I actually wrote a tool which can just input your ID, and it will do all sorts of analytics based on the public Google Plus behavior. So that was 2011, so 2 years ago the talk would have been over now. But not so now. Let's fast forward to 2012. What we see here, there's a lot of new things coming in. we still have the HTTP API, only that now you had access to comments, you had access to people who plus one posts, you could actually search for activities, you could search for people, so there are whole new lot of API calls which you could do. They experimented with something that's called the history API, which doesn't exist anymore now, but they moved it to a different part, which I'm going to talk about a little bit later. We had a couple more plugins. In addition to the plus one button, they added a share button. They actually added patches, the one I showed earlier, which I had to render manually. They added the possibility to render a profile patch for your site, which you can just put the simple code snippet in, and you have your profile displayed on your website. They started with mobile SDKs, still in developer preview, which allowed you to sign in on Android and iOS devices with your Google Plus account, which allowed you to share from your mobile application to Google Plus, and you could add a plus one button to your application. And the biggest part of 2011, which they added, is the Hangouts API. I don't know how many have been to my session about it yesterday. Quite a few, so you know a little bit of what I'm going to talk about. Now, you had the boring part where I showed you how to do it yesterday. Today, I'm just going to show some fun stuff which you can do with it. So basically, the Hangouts API, what it allows you to do, I don't know how many people know what Google Hangouts are. Everyone? How many have been in a Google Plus Hangout in a video call? Okay, quite a few. So basically, what it allows you to do, you have the video call running in your Hangout, and then you can write an application which is displayed instead of the video frame, and you have APIs to interact with the participants. You can exchange data, and you take a web application just written in HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and you add some calls, and you have actually a collaborative web application where everyone in the Hangout can participate in your application. So that's just the basic layout of a Hangout application, where you write an XML file, you include your CSS, you include the JavaScript file, which allows you access to the Hangouts API, and then you just write normally your HTML and your script, and you have some special calls. For example, you have access to the participants in your Hangout. So what you want to do, you have an event call, which allows you to react to when people join the Hangout, when people leave the Hangout, when people start your application, when people close your application. You have all sorts of events you can register, and then you can get the information about each of the participants. For example, if they actually have video enabled, and you get some basic information. So you can use this information to signify if you make changes, if somebody makes a change, you can use this information to show to others who made a change in your document, for example. Now, if you want to exchange data in a Hangout, you actually have two possibilities. You have the shared state and you have messages. The shared state it's really a stable, you have keys, you have values for the keys, and you have a stable state inside of the Hangout. And as long as the Hangout is running, this state will be preserved. So you can actually, if somebody leaves and comes back in, you will have access to the same state that was in there before. It's slower to write, and one of the problems is if two people write the same value to the same key at once, the one who writes later just overwrites the other one. So there are no mechanisms to prevent this. So if you want to make sure, you have to think of some mechanisms to implement this yourself. On the other side, you have messages, which allow you to quickly send out broadcast messages to all others. You can use this, for example, if you have a game and you have the position of each participant, you can just push out the position of each participant regularly, so everybody has an updated state. The problem with this is you can't be sure a message arrives, so it's often safer to just send out more messages than necessary, but it's really quick, so we are talking about a couple of milliseconds of like in this area. So that's really interesting if we are talking about games, really, because you can really quickly update everyone about what's going on. To give you an example of how to use those, let's start a Hangout actually. So we have a Rubik's Cube. And because the Hangout is boring alone, I'm just going to join myself in the Hangout. So one thing about Hangout developing is this, that you often hang out with yourself quite a lot. let's see. I'm in a video Hangout. Let's join. Yep, there I am. And I'm going to start the same application on this side. So what I wanted to do here, I just have to mute him. So what would I want to show with this is I have a Rubik's Cube and I want people in the same Hangout to play with it. So if I go over to this laptop here and start moving something here, you see it pretty instantaneous, so I click and it moves on the other side as well. So they are perfectly synced between the two, and let's just shuffle this up for a bit. So basically you could solve this Rubik's Cube together now, but we don't have the time for that now. But what you can do, let's just take a look at the actually what's going on in the background. So usually when you want to debug Hangout applications, you can do it directly in the JavaScript console. So actually I'm just going to call a call to the API, api.hangout.data.getState. And what I get here is the current positioning of the cube. So I have the current position of the cube, and because I'm lazy, let's just see. I actually have a saved configuration of the cube here. And what I want to do here is I just call debug.hangout.data.setValue and set cube to, and there you go, solved. Of course, what you could also do is, so that's the easy way to solve a Rubik's Cube, it's just like beating off the stickers or. So that's actually, I wanted to show this to show you that it's really easy to manipulate the state of a Hangout if you are inside of the Hangout. So if anybody comes in, and everybody in the Hangout has access to this API really if they are connected. So you always have to make sure to somebody can do something like this and turn your whole cube yellow or any other color. So you can't rely, so you have to have mechanisms in your application itself to check if the state stays valid and know if, for example, if you're doing games, it's really easy to cheat. So usually that's self-regulating in a Hangout, because if somebody's always cheating in a Hangout game, nobody will play with them anymore, so usually it's self-regulating. But there are also, if you have anything that involves money in a Hangout application, you will have to be careful about that one. At least have some server backend to control. So that was the shared state. Another thing you can do in Hangouts, you can put overlays on your video. So you just take an image, put it somewhere on the video frame, and all the other people in the Hangout will see it. So for example, you can use it for serious stuff, like in Hangout Toolbox, you can have a level third if you want to have want to look more professional and have like a talk show happening on Hangouts, and you want everybody to have a nice overlay, you can use that. Of course, you can also do fun stuff. And one thing I did here, just to demonstrate how this works. So I did an application that actually allows you to draw your own overlays directly. Now the problem is I don't have direct access to the video frame, so I can't draw directly on it. That's why I added an extra drawing pane here. And this just allows me, if I draw, it works. It worked yesterday. it allows me to draw directly on my, oh, mostly not directly, so if I could draw, I could actually draw something nice. I'm just going to, one of the thoughts, you could use it for fun stuff, but one of the things is I also had requests of people who said, okay, they want to display a chart and they want to highlight things on a chart. So one thing I did, you could also include an image in here, like some drawing, and then you could highlight things in the drawing if you wanted. And you have different colors and everything, so you have the possibility to, and everybody else in the Hangout, and also if you're doing a Hangout on air, all the people who are watching your live stream would be able to see this. And what I'm doing here, I'm just having a canvas object here where I do the actual drawing, and then I take the data URI of the canvas and convert it in an overlay, and whenever something changes on the canvas, I create a new overlay with the changes. So let's move back. Yeah, and just to show a little bit of how this works, first what you want to do is you create an image resource with some URL. This can be just an image file on the server, but it can also be a data URI for dynamic data like I showed. Then from this image resource, you create an overlay. In this case, this is a face tracking overlay, which means it will move with your face. Or you can create a stable overlay, and also recently they added hand tracking, so you could have a hand tracking overlay which follows your hand. And then you have different parameters which you can set. For example, for the face tracking overlay, you can define which point on your face it's hooked to, if you wanted to have it at the left eye, if you want to have it at the nose. And then from this position, you can set a scale, how big the image will be related to the original size, and also an offset if you want to just move it left, right, of the position it's hooked to the face. So if you want to have a head, you will, or maybe use the nose and lift it up, and then you have the head in the right position. So that's it for the Hangouts API. There are quite a few more things which can be done with it, especially in the Hangouts on Air area. When you're doing live streams, you have controls over the broadcast itself, who can be visible, who's the current person who's visible in the live stream. You can have control over the volumes of each participant, so if somebody has very loud background noise, you can just tune him down. So there are quite a few things you can do here. And the easiest way to actually play around with Hangouts is just to start any application, Hangout application really, because you can then, as I showed, go into the console, open the red ring, and if you call the gappy.hangout, this is the namespace where all the API calls are in. You can actually just take a look at what's available. So you have the data, which is for the data exchange, which I showed. You have the whole audio video where you can add the overlay effects, face tracking, hand tracking. You can actually get the URL of the current Hangout if you want to take the URL and post it automatically to some people so they can join. You have access to all the participants, and you also have the... And then you have this on-air namespace where all the important information for the live streamer, so you can actually get the YouTube video ID of the live stream you're currently streaming. Yeah, so a whole bunch of things that are possible. I'm mostly just doing the fun stuff, but there you can also do serious application, like I showed the Hangout Toolbox earlier where you had the lower third displayed, and actually the Hangout Toolbox also allows you to bring in comments from people commenting on your YouTube live stream, for example, to react to your audience live. But yeah. So I actually last year I did a whole session just about the Hangouts API because there's just so much you could cover with it. But today we are going to move on. So that was 2012. Let's make a jump forward to how it's now. There's a whole bunch of new stuff that happened this year, very interesting stuff. We have the Domains API. How many people have heard about the Domains API? Don't want. Okay. So basically what it did, most people were complaining that there's no way to actually write to Google Plus. Google Plus was always a just read API only, but now what they did is they don't want to have the write API completely public just yet, because they are afraid of people spamming and just putting lots of filling your stream with things you're not interested in. So what they did is they launched the domains API, which has full access to Google Plus, writing, reading. It has possibilities to manage your circles. With the restrictions, you can only use this inside, if you have a Google Apps domain, inside of your domain. So you can't post publicly, but if you have your company, and you can post, make, create posts inside of your domain. So the posts that will be visible by other Apps domains users, and you have, you can define circles you want to share with. So that's actually a full read and write API for Google Plus, but with domain restrictions. So you can't post anything out of your domain. So this is, for example, could be interesting for schools which use Google Apps, because they can automatically create circles of each class, and then they can automatically create posts with course material. So the teacher, they can integrate it with the system and automatically post stuff to the children without the teacher actually having to every time log into Google Plus and do something. So I think there's a lot of potential there, and I haven't really had time to play with it, and I don't have an Apps account myself. So then, yeah, there's some new stuff that was added to the Hangouts API. So what they did in this year is they started with implementing a dev channel. So they now have a stable Hangouts API channel and a dev channel, and in the dev channel they added lots of interesting new features, mostly in the effects area. And so you can test them, you can send feedback about them, and once they're stable enough, they move the feature to the stable channel. And one feature that was tested this this year, were background replacements. So what background replacements allow you to do, that's closed. So if you're like me and you have a really messy home normally, and your background just doesn't look as nice as it does now, what you can do is you can choose a photo. So I did this application where you can actually choose it of your uploaded Google Plus photos. So you can have any background, and then you just select the background. And what happens is, okay, that's perfect. So it really depends on the lighting. As you see, I'm really translucent now, but you can just, so it's still not perfect yet, but what you can do is you can really, so the lighting isn't the best here, but if the lighting's better, it actually recognizes, it actually doesn't, it isn't green boxing, but it recognizes movements and tries to figure out, okay, this is background, this is foreground, and then it just fades out the background and you can replace it. And you actually also have just the blur option, which will just blur out the background, which is often a little bit, works a little bit better. And also what they added in that, so this actually now moved to the stable channel, even though it's not quite perfect yet. And what they still have in the dev channel now is the hand tracking feature, and they offered, it actually works, somehow it works as long as you have the hand open. I don't know if I have the, you have a hand tracking something. So it's not really, so it's a little bit chucky, and if you close the hand, it stops recognizing it properly. It only recognizes open hands. But actually in the hand tracking itself, it can recognize more hands. So if you see on the side now, it recognized both hands. So it's still very unstable and not very good, but it's getting there. And I think it's, well, again, it's mostly for if you want to do some fun stuff. Really, I can't think of any serious applications where it would really be tracking in a Hangout. So they added a couple of new plugins as well. If you take a look. So if you take a look, it's still the same script which we used 2 years ago, just to have the plus one button, but now you get just a profile badge, you get a bit badge for your page, you get a community badge, you actually can have now really embedded posts in your website, which are fully interactive. So if you have a post which you display on your website, people can directly comment inside of this post and plus one the post. So what I'm using this for, I'm actually just have a simple site where I post some articles sometimes, and what I do, I just include a Google Plus post related to the article, and then I let people use it as a commenting system, so I don't have to implement my own commenting system or use any of the others out there. And this directly is visible on Google Plus and inside of my website. And there are a couple more. Interestingly, this plus one that JS is now also used in other Google entities. For example, you have the YouTube follow buttons which use the plus one.js. So I think at some point they should really rename it, because the reason it's called plus one.js is only that it has been used for the plus one button first, but it really should be a Google or plugin JS by now, but they stick with plus one. So plugins, and now the biggest feature they launched this year was the Google Plus sign-in, which I'm going to spend some time talking about. Basically what it is it allows you to authenticate users with the Google Plus profile on your website. So people sign in via the Google Plus profile on your website. We have a couple of features which are related to this. So actually the Google Plus sign-in can't just be seen as a separate feature. It's more like it includes a couple of features from all those. You have extra features in the HTTP API, which you can use if people are logged in with your Google Plus account, with the Google Plus account. You have the Google Plus sign-in. So actually all the features which are available for webs, for the web on Google Plus sign-in, are also available on Android and iOS through the SDKs. There are a couple of new plugins which only work in combination with the Google Plus sign-in button. And so I'm going to go into a bit of detail about the sign-in button. I don't know how many people have actually seen the sign-in button out in the wild on some websites already. A couple of you. But basically, again, you have the plus one.js, the same one. The only difference is because you do something additional, you need the whole JavaScript backend to do the authentication for client-side applications. You load the client and the plus one.js. And what you do, you just again include a short snippet in your website. You add a callback which will be called after the sign-in process has succeeded. You have your client ID which you register with Google at the APIs console. And then you have a number, you have the plus.login scope which is required to use the sign-in button. But then you can, in here you can add all different Google scopes which you want, so you can use this authentication not only for the Google Plus, you can access Google Drive if you want, you can access YouTube, you can anything that uses a Google scope, you can just add the scopes you need in here and you will have access and can use APIs once you have the access token from the user. So what happens when somebody clicks the button is they get this confirmation flow. For in this case it's just a normal permissions. If you add extra scopes, they would be listed here. For example, if you want access to Drive, it would be listed as extra application here. The only difference that's in this Google Plus sign-in flow that it is this part down here where you can say, okay, I'm using this application and I want other people to know that I'm using this application. Then you can define who is allowed to see that you are using this application. I'm going to show in a bit how this looks like when you show this information, so it doesn't create any posts automatically or anything. It's just so you can, if you really like an application, that's a way to show people, okay, I'm using this, might want to use it too. And the other thing is you can let the application know about people you follow. This is interesting if you want. So the application doesn't automatically know all the people you are following. You can actually define, okay, I only want this application to know that my normal work circle, or I only want to include my game circle for a game. So I don't want this application to know about everything I'm following. I just want to tick off certain circles that I want to know that I want the application to know about. Because what happens is, so once this flow is through, you get a call to your sign-in callback with an access token. And you can then use the client libraries to, in this case, for example, access the Google Plus API. I'm using JavaScript here, but all these calls are just the same if you use Android or iOS or any other API. Really, as soon as you have the access token, you can use this access token in any HTTP calls. For example, in this case, what I'm doing, I'm just doing a simple request. Okay, I have authenticated, I want to get information about the authenticated user. So I'm just doing a people.get request with the special user ID me. This means the one who authenticated, this is the information for him. And this is the new one, which only works with Google Plus Sign. This is the people.list in the collection visible. What this does, it returns a list of people who are in the circles like defined earlier. So this allows an application to show you a list of your friends. It allows you to show, hey, look, those friends of yours are already using this application. You can hook up with them in my application. Or for example, if you're using games, you can show, so this is the public leaderboard, and you can also show a leaderboard just including your friends. So this was just client side. So many applications will need access server side to do have offline access. And so what happens is you have the client side flow happened and you get an access token. And what they do, they didn't do the normal overflow with other way you get redirected to a page and redirected back. Instead, they did a full client side flow and you get an extra code which you then send to a server and the server in combination with the client secret and client that you can exchange this code to get an access token and a refresh token and can store this on the server side. So what happens is you go through this client side flow, you get this code on the client side and then you just send this code to the server. So for this case you just say you want offline access. And in the signing callback, you get this authResult.code, and you send this to a server, then you can exchange this code for having access at the server side. Now this code, it only works if you don't do it right after the signing flow happened, the code will just expire. I think it's just a minute or what, maybe less, that the code is actually valid, so you actually have to go through the flow immediately. Afterwards, the code isn't valid, you would have to sign in the user again if you want to have server side access. So there's a couple of features why I think Google Plus Sign-In is useful. There's the one thing, of course, you can personalize your application. You have access to the user itself, so you can show them their preferred profile picture. They don't have to add the information manually again. They just sign in, get the information, and you can display them. Okay, you are signed in now as you. As I showed earlier, you also have access to the friends, so you can show them so they don't have to find new friends in the application. They can use the Google Plus social network to interact with the same people they want to interact. And as I showed earlier, you define when you do an application with what people you want to interact in this application. If you don't want any, you just remove all circles and nobody will know that you're using the application, and the application won't have any information about your friends if you don't want the application to have this information. Another thing, it's very important that this is really cross-platform, so you can use it on Windows, you can use it on any web, you can use it on iOS, you can use it on Android, you can't use it on Windows one yet. And the thing is, actually, they have some extra features. They have cross-platform single sign-on, which means if you have a website where you have the sign-in button, and you have an Android application that goes along with your website, once the people signed up on your website, when they come in into the Android application, they don't have to go through the overflow you go, because the application already knows you signed in on the website. We know you are the same person, so we sign you in automatically in the Android app. And actually, you also have the possibility to, at the first signing flow on your website, you can actually offer people to directly install your Android application. So people sign in on your website, you have an Android application linked to the website, and when the people are using Android and haven't installed the application yet, they will get the confirmation, hey look, do you want to install an Android application as well? Without you just have the client ID in there and people don't have to do anything extra. The other thing which I talked about earlier, discoverability, once a user has allowed people to see that you are using the applications, on your profile you will get a list of applications which you are using. So when people go to your profile to see the applications, in this case you might get more exposure because people see, oh, this friend of mine is using an application, let's check it out, and with a single click they are at the application. And you also have something that's called app activities, which allows you to sort of log information. So if somebody's using an application, you can write activities based on the application, and those applications will also be visible to the people you define. So in this case, I just wrote a simple something like a spotlight for Last.fm. I just wrote something that takes track of what I'm listening to on Google Music, and then creates activities for me, so I have a list of music I listen to on actually visible on my Google Plus profile via the extension I wrote. The way you do app activities is that you actually request some extra access to write app activities for your user. In the sign up button you request visible access, so you have a couple of activities which you can do. You have add, you have listen, you have create, you have comment, I don't know, there's a check-in activity if you want to do a check-in application. And then you just, and an activity itself, it basically is just the type and some public URL which is the target. For example, if you're doing a check-in, the target would be the explanation of the location. If you have a song, the target would be the page about the song. And then you just make a simple call to moments.insert, and it will add the activity to the Google Plus activity. Now the thing is, at the moment, this is only visible on the profile. If you explicitly go to see it, they said that they are planning to include some information in the extended Google search. So if you have a big page like, let's take Last.fm, and they would use song tracking like this, and somebody searched for a song on Google search, they could actually display information like 10,000 other people listen to the song on Last.fm, because they have the information in the backend. So I don't know how you actually get to be this, or probably have to be really a Google partner with a huge user case to actually get in there, but I asked them about it, and what they said is you just start writing your app activities, and once we see that you have a huge user base, we will do the rest for you automatically. What's this? So the other thing which you have with Google Plus sign-in is interactive posts. So what this is, it is like a share, but not quite, because it allows you to add an extra button basically to post. So what this happens is you have actually two links in a post where you just link to the basic information, and in your backend you can have this call to action button do something more. So for example, if you have, let's take Amazon, and you just, somebody wants to share something they like, so they have a book they like, they share it. And with the call to action button, you could actually implement something like that the book is directly added to your
shopping cart.
Thanks. So that it's directly added to the shopping cart. And this also allows direct interaction. If you have an Android application, you can use this to deep link into your application to allow people to perform direct actions inside of your Android application when they use the button and are signed into your application. What you also got, once you use Google Plus sign-in and have some extra features, so if you just use the Google Plus sign-in button and have it linked to your Google Plus page, so you have your Google Plus page which goes with your Google Plus application, sign-in application, you actually get quite a bit of information. You get how many people are signing in with your application each day, so you don't need any extra analytics. They do quite a bit of analytics already, so you get how many people have signed in with your application, from what platforms. You get information how many people use your interactive posts, how many app activities have been written. And actually for the interactive post, you also get information how many people clicked on this interactive post to go to your website, how many people clicked on the call to action button, how many people actually saw the interactive post in your stream. So you get quite a bit of analytics for free. Well, analytics are free anyway, but you get quite a bit of extra information if people use the Google Plus sign-in button on your website. And with that, I think we're in good time. So these are just basically just a couple of links you want to remember. The slides are going to be public afterwards, so you don't have to remember the links now. I just put them in the slides, so you have them there. So you have them, developers.google.com/plus, which includes all the SDK and API references, samples, everything you want. We have the APIs console, which you use if you to create your access keys and client IDs to actually be able to access the Google Plus APIs. Yeah, you have some downloads of samples. Then here, so maybe this allmyplus.com/dev, this is maybe, this is where we'll be hosting all my stuff, and I also have some samples for everything on there. I have a lot of open source code on GitHub, where I have lots of samples for Google Plus and other stuff and more. And you can also just find me on Google Plus, so do contact me if you need something. And with that, so we've covered just quite a bit. So are there any questions? I'll be around all day later as well if you need something. I know it's quite a bit. As I said, if you come up with any questions later, I'm around all day, so thanks.